Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing this morning? I hope y'all are doing okay. We're going to be reading first out of Matthew chapter 2. Kind of told Aaron I stole his message, but that's not really true. I at least stole the passage that he preached from. Aaron preached about the wise men, and I titled this morning's message, The Star of Bethlehem. So today, the focal point is really on the Star of Bethlehem, all right? So we're gonna read out of Matthew chapter 2 real quick, starting in verse 1. Matthew chapter 2, starting in verse 1. Now when Jesus was born, sounds like people are still turning pages. Either that or he came or whatever. That's cool too. All right. I heard the crinkling stop. Here we go. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.' Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem, and said, Go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they had saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy, and when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. When they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh." You know, truthfully, Aaron did preach this passage the other night, and he said some really good things that kind of stuck out to me. And I know that recently I actually preached similarly on this passage for Christmas and pointed out some various things. There's a lot of different things that are going on in the story. For instance, you know, since the beginning of time, God has promised that he was going to send a king, amen? And we ultimately know that that king was Jesus, and that God's desire for that king is that he would rule and reign on the inside of individual hearts, amen. And I want you to know that while some of the things that stick out to me in this story again are that Herod was a counterfeit king, that he came from the descendants of Esau, which was Jacob's twin brother, if you'll remember that. Jacob was the line or the lineage that the promise came through. If you'll remember the story of Abraham, that Abraham had a son, amen, and his son's name was Isaac, and then Isaac had two sons. And his two sons were Jacob and Esau. And ultimately, Esau sold his birthright, and so therefore, he was no longer the one that the promised heir came through. Instead, it came through Jacob, his younger twin. And that's very important for the story, because from that point moving forward, God has chronicled in his word how this was going to come about, how this promised king, this governor, this ruler, this God, this counselor was going to come to man, and that ultimately, the people of Israel knew that he would be a descendant of Abraham, that he would be a descendant of Jacob, and many of the prophecies surrounded the fact that this Messiah, this anointed one, would come from the lineage of Jacob, and then later on we knew that he would come from the lineage of David. And we see within this story so many of these fulfillments taking place, and I know that I pointed this out whenever I preached on Christmas, the fact, so many prophecies that were fulfilled just through the birth of Jesus. This morning, to be truthful, to some extent, I'm kind of focused more on the star of Bethlehem. And one of the things, you know, I started kind of thinking about stars, and I was doing a little bit of research. I'm not trying to get all technical because I'm not a scientist. But one of the things that one little site gave a definition of what it was, I was like, what is a star, you know? And one of the definitions that came up was, it said it was a huge sphere of very hot glowing gas Stars produce their own light energy through this thing called nuclear fusion. It's kind of like a nuclear reaction that's taking place in the midst of this star. Our sun is considered a star. Typically, the little bit of research that I did, stars don't really do a whole lot of moving. Truly, stars don't. The fact of the matter is that the Earth is rotating and it's moving in its orbit, so it makes certain stars that you can see look different in various places of the sky. But usually, a star doesn't really move. However, scientists or astronomers will call planets wandering stars, because they're considered a star also. They cast light. And that's some of the, so they produce energy, and when this happens, it creates heat, it creates energy, it causes a shine to take place. So some of the things simply about stars that to me are important for this particular message that I'm preaching this morning is that star, it's okay, I hope that I produce on that I preach to you on stars. I'm not trying to be an astronomer, or certainly not trying to be an astrologer, but I want to talk to you about this star this morning. Stars produce light. That's one thing I want you to know about stars. They produce light. But not only that, stars also separate darkness from light. Because when you look up in the sky, you can see in this darkened sky at nighttime, you can see the light of the stars. And so there's a separation that takes place between the light and the darkness. And for years, thousands of years of human history, stars have provided navigational coordinates for human beings. Human beings use the stars to navigate themselves and to coordinate, to find the direction that they need to go. Mariners have been well known to plot the stars, and that's how they would get from point A to point B. This is kind of like a little bit off the beaten path, but I was also thinking, why in the world do we call actors stars? Don't ask me why I was thinking of that. But guess what? I kind of looked into that, you know, and one thing that somebody said on Google was that because there's a difference between actors and stars. That, and all of them act, but the reality of it is that some act so well and take over the stage that they have some form of brilliance is what they described, and that they're brighter than the rest of them, and so they kind of explode on the stage and they get everybody's attention, and that's kind of what a star does in the sky, get your attention, and so that's why they call some actors stars. And maybe this will kind of come into play at some point in time, but nevertheless, I was just thinking about the word stars and how we use it, you know, so no matter what your definition of a star is, we know that it's a shining light in the middle of a dark place. Because I think we can all agree that Hollywood's a pretty dark place, right? And so stars shine light in the midst of darkness. And so we talked about the fact that stars don't really move, but that there's a wandering star. And there's a lot of different opinions about the Star of Bethlehem. You know, Aaron brought it up that Jessica had told him about a video, and I've watched the video before. It was a video called The Star of Bethlehem, and you can Google it. Just Google The Star of Bethlehem, and this video talks about, it's an attorney that was just doing a little project. He was going to do something. His neighborhood was decorating, from what I remember. It's been a while since I watched the video. His neighborhood was decorating, and he had something that wanted to do something with the star, from what I remember, and he started to research the Star of Bethlehem, and he just came up with some amazing information, because there's these astronomical computer programs now that can plot thousands of years in the past and thousands, and even plot some things that are going to take place in the future of the alignment of these stars. And the conclusion that people have come to is that what happened on that day was an astronomical phenomenon, that it didn't really necessarily transcend the law of physics, or I think it's really specifically called Kepler's law, where these stars go, but that in actuality certain things only take place ever so often, and certain things in the stars sometimes only take place once in a lifetime that we would know about. And that supposedly what could have happened on this particular night was that Jupiter and Venus, two wandering stars, came so close to one another that the brilliance of that light shone as only one star. Now, what's interesting is if you study a little bit about planets, and I didn't mean to get into all this, but that Jupiter's the largest planet, so it's called the king planet. And that, so at the time frame, many people believe that at conception, that these two planets came together and provided the brilliance in the sky that allowed these wise men to say, we saw his star in the east. In other words, when the conception took place is whenever they first saw the star, and then that star led them and guided them. More specifically, you'll see that whenever they went and they spoke to Herod, what ended up happening is that they saw that same star that they had seen in the east, and that it went before them and it rested upon the top of the house where Jesus actually was. Now, many people say this also, that not only did that star with that brilliance that shined in the sky on that day of near the conception took place, but that approximately 9 months later would have been the time frame that something else happened, that Jupiter and another star called Regulus, which is supposed to be the king star because it's the largest of stars, were next to one another again, also creating this brilliance of light. It's just amazing to me to think. I can't prove any of this to you. I'm not, once again, an astronomer. I'm not even a scientist, but I'm telling you that they can prove these things happened near the date and time frame that Jesus was born. And since God created the stars and scattered them in the sky, surely He can use the stars to speak forth what it is that He desires to speak forth. Amen. And He could have caused it to happen in a way that took place naturally through the natural course and the movement of these planetary bodies. Now, I have to tell you that I believe that there's also times that God doesn't have to go according to the law of physics. I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't think that He doesn't have to operate within Kepler's law. He doesn't have to operate within Newton's law. God created the law of gravity. God created the law that caused the planetary bodies to move in motion. But what I will tell you is this, is that from the beginning of time, God has been separating darkness from light. Amen. Turn to Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. In Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, this is my point number one, separating darkness from light. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and darkness He called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. God, before even the sun was created, even before the moon was created, He separated darkness from light. Now, the only way that I can wrap my mind around this is that God allowed His light to separate at that moment in time in the process of creation the darkness from the light. But if you go down a few verses later, in verses 14 through 18, God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night." God caused a division to take place, a separation to take place between light and between darkness. "And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so." Now, I didn't even get into this, but you can see where He said specifically that these lights, and He's talking about lights in the sky, the luminaries. Whenever you go outside and you look at, well, I tell you, the last couple of nights has been some beautiful nights with the full moon that I think was on Thursday, and then every night after that, and the way the clouds were in the sky, and the way it illuminated the sky, and sometimes even whenever it was real cold, I don't know if y'all noticed or not, but when it was real cold, the sky was clear, and you could see all of these stars and these lights in the night. But God said, "Let them be for signs." Also, I didn't want to get into this part of it, but the truth be told is that this light that took place in that sky on that night and with the Star of Bethlehem was a sign. It was a sign for these wise men, whatever they were. You know, that was one of the points that Aaron brought out, that possibly they could have been part of a Jewish remnant. You know, and we don't have any way to prove that. The reason he makes that point is, if you're familiar with the Babylonian captivity and you understand the way that Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego were taken as slaves, really, to be used as servants for the king, then, you know, and not only them, but a large portion of the Jewish population. And we learn really from the book of Esther, if you look at the history and the chronology of Esther, that even though people had returned to Jerusalem to rebuild the wall and the temple, many of the Jewish people stayed in Babylon, stayed in Persia, because now Persia had taken over Babylon. And so Aaron's point was that there's the possibility that some of these wise men were actually of Jewish origin, because one of the questions that he had was, why in the world would these people be seeking out this king of the Jews? But also, got to tell you, this is just another postulation, another hypothesis, another thought process, that Daniel, who was part of that trip, if you will, that took place from Jerusalem to over there, and he interpreted the dream of the king. He was in the midst of all of these wise men that they called them, these astrologers, these magicians, or whatever the case. They served another god. They went another way. But Daniel was in the midst of all of them. He was in the middle of them. He was a light in the middle of their darkness. They didn't know the God of the Jews, but Daniel took a stand throughout the entirety of his life. You'll remember the story when he was actually thrown into the lion's den specifically because of the fact that he refused not to worship the God that he served. He refused not to bow down. He would not bow down his knee to the false gods of Babylon, but instead he was going to worship the God of the Jews. And the God of the Jews saved him from the mouth of hungry lions. Now, I got to tell you that story had to begin to spread. Now, Daniel is willing, and once again, I understand I'm reading between the lines, but I'm just putting pieces of the puzzle together. It's not really that hard to do. If Daniel is willing to stand in the face of tyranny like that, to stand in the face of darkness and evil like that, surely he told the people that he worked with, because he was in charge of all of those astrologers and those magicians. Surely he said, hold on a second. You're worshiping false gods. You're looking to false ways. I'm here to tell you the story of a real God that has a real plan, amen, that's going to send a king, going to send a son. And he began to probably tell them about all of these prophecies, whether they had to do with Micah and the fact that he would be born in Bethlehem, that he would be born a child, also the fact that stars were going to rise. We'll look at one of those verses at the end of the message, that a star would rise up. And the point being is this, is that I believe that this story was filtered down through the ages, and that these people were waiting. And guess what? I also believe this, and I can't prove it, but I believe this, that whenever they saw that star, that the Holy Spirit did a work in their heart. In other words, it was like no star ever before. Yeah, you got to understand, these people obviously studied the stars. You know what I'm saying? It was nothing for them to look to a star. I'm trying to put myself inside their head. I'm trying to put myself in where they were in the midst of their life. One of the things, so they're used to looking at stars. They're used to looking at planetary movements. They're used to looking at things aligning and things happening in the sky. But when this happened, it caused such a profound effect upon them personally, that whether they knew the story from Daniel or not, it caused them to pack up bags. It caused them to pack up a caravan. People have pointed out the fact that just because there were three gifts doesn't mean there were three wise men, right? That in reality, they caused a trouble in the entirety of the city. Many people believe that it would have been a huge caravan that came through. How long did it take them to pack up and just to prepare for this travel? The point that I'm trying to make is this. You're not even going to get in your car and drive to San Antonio just on a whim. No, something has to affect you. And for them to do this, I'm telling you, them seeing the star, other people saw the brilliance in the sky, I believe. Other people saw the light that took place, and they're like, oh yeah, look at that light in the sky. It didn't have that effect on those people. On these people, it had an effect. I believe that God used that light in that sky to do a work on the inside of their hearts, to begin to lead them and guide them in a particular direction he wanted them to go. It's separate, but what the main point that we're talking about right now is the fact that God has been separating light from darkness. So while we don't know really what the wise men were, because I know that there was a song that said, we three kings from Orient are, or whatever the case. Some people say they were kings. Some people say they were wise men. The Bible calls them magi, which is another word for magician. Many people, we understand that they were astrologers. They looked and studied the stars. We don't know exactly what they were, but I want to make a point of where they came from here in a moment. But before we do that, we're still talking about separating light from darkness. Do me a favor and turn to 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. God has been separating light from darkness. This is what John said in that 1 John letter. We studied this not that long ago. He said, this then is the message that word stuck out to me when I was studying for this sermon. And the word message right there means literally the promise we announce. This then is the promise that we announce, which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. When I began to look at this particular passage of scripture, what John was saying was, this is the message that we heard from him. Who? Jesus, the one that God sent. This is the message that we heard from Jesus 80 years after the fact, 80 years after he died on the cross and he resurrected from the tomb, 80 years after he ascended back to the Father. John says, this is the message that we've heard from him, and this is the message that we're going to declare unto you. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. And I realize that this is exactly why God has been separating darkness from light from the beginning of time. Because he's wanting humanity to understand that he is light, and that there's no darkness in him.
Amen.
And that he desires a separation of darkness and light to take place. Amen. James chapter 1, verses 16 through 18. It says, do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Now, if you go back and you look at this passage from the beginning, he's right on the heels of talking about what lust and sin are. He says that if any man be tempted, let him not say he's tempted by God, because God is not tempted by evil, nor does he tempt any man with evil. But that when you realize that you've been tempted and you realize that sin comes to life, it's because you found out that lust was already on the inside of you. So what he's doing is he's making a contradistinction between lust, which is within mankind, and the light, or the Father, which is, he's the Father of lights. All good gifts come from above. Sin and lust is already in the heart of man. So what God did was, he's light. He gave a gift from above in order to remedy the situation that was on the inside of mankind. And the result of that is this. He says he begat he us. He begat us. He gave birth to us. He, in other words, he allowed you and I to be born and to become a first fruit, the first part of a new creation, which was his plan from the beginning. Once again, a separating out of darkness from light, that when we were born the first time, we were born like Adam with darkness, sin, and lust on the inside of us. But God, the Father of lights, allowed a gift to come from above, amen, to come down unto us, to allow light to shine in the midst of darkness, to allow a separation between darkness and light to take place, and to allow that light, hallelujah, yeah, to come on the inside of us and to produce a new birth on the inside of us. Mm-hmm. But what the wise men said was, we saw his star in the east. And earlier I was trying to make the point that we can't really say for sure what they were, other than that they were wise men and they were magi, but we definitely know one thing, they were from the east. And one of the things that I can tell you about Eastern mysticism or Eastern religion of that day was, these people were pagans. These people served gods that were not the God of the Jewish people. And so in the East, they were in the midst of darkness, is the point that I'm trying to make. God is separating out light from darkness. And when they saw that light in the sky, what ended up happening was that it affected them in such a way that it caused them to make a movement from the place where they were in the east, moving towards Jesus. And one of the things that I began to think about is that every step of the way, I believe that they used camels. Every step of the way, as the camels got further away from the east and closer to Jesus, they moved further from darkness and got closer to the light. God is all about separating light and darkness. And so I wanted you to know that that star provided that very thing for these wise men also. It allowed a separation between darkness and light to take place. Matthew chapter 4, verse 16 says, Matthew 4:16 says, "The people which sat in darkness saw great light. And to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up." Now, what he was talking about right here was, if you go back and you look at the context, he was talking about in Galilee beyond Jordan, a place where the Gentiles lived. But it was Jewish people that were living amongst Gentiles. So what he was saying is that there was a remnant of Jewish people that were living amongst Gentiles that were in the midst of darkness, and that God sent the light of Jesus to those that sat in darkness. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that it doesn't matter whether or not it's the people that don't know God or it's the people that do know God. Sometimes we're plagued by darkness, but God is desiring to separate out light from darkness, amen, and he's desiring to bring light into the darkness. In 2 Peter 1:19, I wanted to end this first point with this. The disciple Peter says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well, that you take heed as unto a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts." What Peter's talking about is, he's using the analogy of a star, the light that comes from a star that rises in the sky, just like the sun rises. And there's certain stars that actually rise with the sun or whatever the case, that whenever the light of God enters into your heart, it's like the brilliance or the light that dispels the darkness. And that the word of prophecy, which was given by the word of God, that when the Holy Spirit moved upon men of old and spoke the truth through them that revealed Jesus, that whenever you or I, any man, woman, or child, for thousands of years that have heard the word of prophecy that spoke of Jesus, when we believe that, it's like a day star that rises on the inside of our heart. If you've gotten saved already, you know what I'm talking about. You were already in the midst of darkness. You couldn't see. You couldn't see the difference between good and evil. You couldn't see the difference. You couldn't even see the concept of the kingdom of God many times. I know one of the things that Robert would tell me is that before he went to prison, he gave me permission a long time ago to use his testimony. Before he ever went to prison for being a drug dealer, he said, "Man, I wasn't a spiritual person. I was an altar boy, but I didn't believe in any of that stuff." He said, "But whenever I heard the message of Jesus Christ," he said it was a guy that I was living in a cell with. "When I heard the message of Jesus Christ, and one night I was laying in my bed, and he said, and I cried out to God," he said, "all of a sudden something happened to me and I couldn't refute it. Something spiritual happened to me and it changed me." When you get saved, you don't have to believe it. I mean, you have to believe it to get saved. Many people refuse to believe it, and therefore the day star will never rise in the inside of their heart. And they continue to look at it because they cannot see the truth. People who believe as though they were crazy. But I'm here to tell you right now that Jesus told Nicodemus that unless a man is born again, he cannot see. Amen. Without light, you can't see. You remain in darkness. Your eyes are scaled. Your eyes are closed. You cannot see. But when you believe the truth about Jesus Christ, hallelujah, the light rises on the inside of your heart and it allows you to be able to see the truth. Amen. God is desiring from the beginning to separate light and darkness. And ultimately, the plan was to bring light to man and for that light to enter man and for it to separate light from darkness on the inside of who we are. The light showed up in their darkness. I'm talking about the wise men. They were in the east. They were in the midst of darkness. And the light showed up in their darkness and it moved them from point A to point B. Do you remember where your east was? I mean, you know, that's for you in your own personal life. Where was your east? What do you mean? Well, I can just remember part of my east. I don't even know why, but I mean, I was just thinking about this. There's so many things to remember. Part of my east was I didn't have really a place to go. I was so broke down, and so I had one change of clothes on my back. And I was staying in this apartment with this guy. I don't even remember what his name was. And I was just such a mess.
And I can remember the darkness. I was probably 19 years old. And I can remember the darkness trying to grip me. And everything that I thought that my flesh desired and everything that I thought was going to bring me happiness was resulting in more pain, more sorrow. And I didn't even realize it at the time, but depression was trying to grip me. Darkness was trying to grip me. The lies of the enemy were trying to grip me, trying to tell me things in my head that never belonged inside of a person's head. That's the only time that ever really happened, but I remember how dark that was. I don't know where your east was, but I'm here to tell you that God sends light to people that are in the east. God sends light to people that are in the dark. God desires to separate and divide light from dark. He wants to make it real clear what the difference is. And if we will begin to look towards the light and begin to move in that direction, He will lead and guide us to where He desires us to be. He showed up in the east for these men and moved them further away from darkness. And that brings me to my next point, the guiding light. Just as from the beginning of time, God separated darkness from light, He also used light to guide His people. Exodus chapter 13, verses 21 through 22. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, to go by day and night. He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. I never really thought of this before like this, you know? And I still can't say that this fire in the sky was some type of a star. I can't, you know? But what I can say is that a star is a ball of fire in the sky in the night. So whether this was some type of a star that was leading and guiding the children of Israel, that God was breaking the laws of physics and Kepler's law, and He says, I'm going to cause this star to do what I'm telling it to do. And my point is that if He'd done it in the past, He can do it. He could have done it on the night of Jesus, and He can do it in the future. He can cause anything to happen that He wants to happen. Or maybe it wasn't even in the sky that high. Maybe it was just right there above them. I don't really know. But I do know that God has been using light in darkness, as He did in this situation, to give guidance and to give direction to people as they travel from point A to point B. And this is what the wise men said. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them. Or this is what the Bible says about the wise men. The star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. So the same star that they saw in the east that separated them from the darkness that they were in also from that point began to guide them and further them in their direction to move them even closer towards Jesus. Just as the fire in the sky led the children of Israel to the place that He was desiring for them to be. They had just been Egyptian slaves. They had just been delivered out through the Passover. They had just gone through on dry ground through the Red Sea, and God was... His plan was to bring them to a land of promise known as the Promised Land. And just the same way that that fire in the sky was leading and guiding them, this star, this light in the sky was leading and guiding these wise men to the place where He desired for them to be. The star, the light of the star, guided them to their destination. I need you to know that God, once again, has been using light. Psalm 119, 105. God uses light to guide His people in the direction and the path that He desires for them to go. I use this verse a lot. But you know, this is the type of verse that people ought to have memorized inside of their hearts. Amen? Psalm 119, 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Just as there are stars in the sky that separate and also provide guidance, just as the fire was in the sky, a light that provided guidance, God's word is known as a light. And let me tell you something, we needed light in the midst of this darkness that we are in. God provides light through His word to be a lamp unto your feet. Amen. I always say this, and I hope you don't get tired of it. Some of you haven't heard me say it before. But you know, a lamp to your feet is going to show you right here where you are and where you need to go next. Like immediate circumstances. I need to know where to take my next step. If I don't have a lamp by my feet, I'm not going to know where to take my next step. I can't see. See, you don't want to. It's a bad thing if you can't see. The other night, man, it was dark, and I ran into my. I got this big old thick bed frame, and I ran. I slammed into that thing. It caused a big old hematoma on my leg. I was in a mess for a week. You want to be able to see where you're going to take your next step. You want to be able to take a step. You want to know where you're going. But not only is it a lamp unto your feet, but it's also a light unto your path. The pathway talks about the journey. The pathway talks about providing illumination for the direction that you need to go, the long term. God wants to lead and guide you every step of the way, and he wants to bring you to the right destination. Just as his plan for Israel was to bring them to the right destination, just as his plan for the wise men was to bring them to the right destination, the word of God is going to bring you to the right destination. Amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 1 verse 79 says, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. God desires to guide our feet into the way of peace. Now, I can tell you that the way of peace is Jesus. He's the Prince of Peace, and we'll get into that a little bit more at the end of the sermon. But, you know, the way of peace is in the midst of God's will. Walking in God's will, walking God's path. Being in union with him and his will for your life. What I know is this, is that the word of the Old Testament pointed to the fact that he would come, talking about Jesus. All the prophecies, all the words of the Old Testament kept pointing to the fact that Jesus, the light of the world, would come, and all the words of the New Testament proved the fact that he did indeed come. The Bible teaches us in multiple places that he is literally the Word of God. And I want you to remember what John said. John said, this is the message. This is the promise we declare. God is light. And I need you to know that God sent his light to guide us away from darkness into a path of peace with him. And if we're at peace with him, I got to tell you that we will be at peace with others. Many times we consider our lives, we consider the turmoil that goes on and the chaos that's taking place. We look at how we're at odds with people that we know, people that we love. And the reality of it is that the reason that we're not at peace with them is because we're not at peace with God. God desires for us to be at peace with him. And if we will do that, he will begin to move and operate in our lives. And he will cause peace to take place with those other people. Amen. That was point number two, the guiding light. First, God sent light to separate light from darkness. Second, God uses light to guide people in the direction that he would have them to do. But the third thing that I saw from this passage of scripture about this star was that the light exposed the evidence. If you go back, to the Matthew chapter 2 narrative, it said in verse 2, it said, not verse 2, I'm sorry, verse 9, it said, the star which they saw in the east went before them. That word before stuck out to me. It went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And then ultimately it says, when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, and frankincense and myrrh. The two main points that I wanted to bring out right there was the light. Well, the point is the light exposed the evidence. But what I wanted you to see was that it says that the light went before them. And I'm focused on that word before. And ultimately where it brought them to their destination, they fell down and worshipped him. The word before right there means to go before, to bring forth something that was hidden from view. Even in the Greek language, somehow this word before describes bringing someone forth to a trial. It has to do with evidence. It reveals something that was previously hidden, and it exposes it and makes it to be able to be clearly seen. And that's exactly what this star did. It brought them from the east where they were in the midst of darkness, and ultimately it exposed the evidence that they were looking for. They were able to find what it was that they were looking for, and when they found it, the Bible says that they worshiped him. Now, I can tell you that this word worshiped in the Greek language is proskuneo. It has a couple of different concepts to it that kind of give you an overall understanding of what the word means. One of the words literally means to lick or kiss the hand. The idea is that kind of like a dog with its master, that it sits there and it waits and it loves its master and it's just waiting for its next command, and it loves its master so much and it's sitting there kissing its hand. But it also means, I don't mean to get weird on you, but it means to prostrate oneself, to lay down and to prostrate oneself. I started to think about that word, to lay life down. That's what the word worship literally means, to lay life down. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like that's a hard thing to do, to lay life down. But to worship God doesn't just mean in the midst of a music service. It doesn't mean to lift your hand up. It means to lay your life down. The way that you worship God is really with your life, giving it back to Him. The Lord gave me a revelation of this a long time ago, and even though I have an understanding of it, I don't always get it right. But what the Lord revealed to me is this, is that just as Jesus laid His life down for us, God is desiring for us to lay our life down for Him. When they saw the evidence of the star that went before them, and it revealed the evidence to them, the result was that they worshiped Him. Aaron brought out, and I thought that was good. I'd never heard anybody say that before, that was actually the fourth gift, or really the first gift. They brought three gifts with them, but the first gift was that they worshiped Him. Now, what that does is that it brings a whole new meaning to the way the gifts were, because once again, the gifts were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold representing His royalty, the fulfillment of the prophecies that said He would be a king. Frankincense was a certain type of incense that was used by the high priest in the work that they did in the tabernacle and also in the temple. So it describes His priestly role. And then myrrh was an embalming fluid that was used in the death, in a dead body, to preserve the body, the death. Previously, I just would focus on those three: gold, His kingship; frankincense, His priestly role; and myrrh, His death on Calvary. Never seeing really the fact that they worshipped Him. If you look throughout the entirety of Scripture, especially in the book of Revelation, when this angel is giving the revelation of Jesus, he's unfolding Jesus before John's eyes. He's letting him see, listen, this is what it's going to look like in the end. The whole world is going to see Him. All eyes are going to be able to behold Him. And when John sees the magnitude of the message that this angel has given him, the Bible says he falls down on his face. He proskuneos. He prostrates himself. He lays his life down. The angel says, don't you do it. I'm a fellow servant. You worship God. These men were led by this light that was in the midst of darkness and brought them from the east, their darkness, to the light. And when they saw the evidence of where God wanted to bring them, they laid their life down before Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The star was the light that was leading them to the evidence, and when they got there, the result was that they worshiped Him. The light of the Word goes before us as evidence, just as the light of the star did for them. As we study and learn what God said, the Holy Spirit is leading us to the conclusion that Jesus is the ultimate result of the journey. He is the light that separates the darkness. He is the light that leads to the promised land. Amen? Just like the light that was in the sky that led the children of Israel to the physical promised land. But ultimately, that wasn't the final destination. That was just to allow them to become a nation so that Jesus could be born, so that He, the light, the Word that was manifest, the light that was given as a gift from the Father and given to man, could lead us to the land that God has promised us, the final destination for humanity. Amen. As we serve Him and live for Him, and that ultimately we come to the final resting place where God would have us in an eternal relationship with God the Father. He is the king that the wise men searched for, but when they got there, they realized He wasn't just a king, He was God, and they worshiped Him. And just as the star did for the wise men, God wants the light to lead all men to Jesus. And once they are there, they will make a decision on what they're going to do with Him. They chose to worship Him. And as we said, the word worship means to lay self down. If you could lay your life down, if you could go to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Really, what I guess I was trying to say right there is that
I equated the light of the word to the light that was in the sky, right? Because the light in the sky guided them, and the light of the word guides us. And when the evidence of the word brings us to the right place, we come to the realization that the evidence is clear, that this is who Jesus was. The reason I went to Isaiah 9, verse 6 is not only because it's a Christmas passage and it's a Christmas story. I know it's not Christmas anymore, but it's always Christmas, really, because it's a story about Jesus being born in the midst of the earth, and then for that gift to be born on the inside of our hearts. It says right here in Isaiah 9, verse 6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder." That's talking about a governor. See, the wise men came looking for the king of the Jews. And Herod said, "Well, where's the ruler going to be born?" He knew. This prophecy, 600 years before Jesus ever showed up, talked about the fact that the promised one that would come from Israel was going to be born a king. But not only that, it also called him wonderful, and it called him counselor. One who advises, one who deliberates. It's almost like the idea of an attorney in a certain sense. You ever needed advice? You ever needed somebody to go before you and to plead your cause? Amen. Maybe you're going through something right now. You need a counselor. You need somebody to go before you and to plead your cause. I'm here to tell you, Jesus is the answer to that. Amen. He's the Almighty. He's the mighty God. He's the everlasting Father. Jesus ultimately is the manifestation of God in the flesh. Amen. And when you come to him, you must worship him. There's a whole lot. I don't need to get on all them and start throwing all that out there right now. But there's all kind of lies out there right now that would say Jesus isn't God. No, this prophecy right here tells us that the same one, the one that was going to be a child born, the one that was going to be a son given, the one that would be a ruler, a governor, a king, and that the governments would be on his shoulder, the same one that would be called wonderful, the same one that would be a counselor, would also be the mighty God. He would also be the everlasting Father, and he would also be, hallelujah, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Amen. Now, I got to tell you that the way that he provided peace, it all goes back to the cross. Can you put Colossians 1:20 up there? See, God is the Father of lights. And you and I, born of Adam, were born in the midst of darkness. And God brings his light into the midst of our darkness. There's got to be a place where the light and the dark can meet. And the place where the light and the dark meet is where the light Jesus allowed darkness to be placed on him, your darkness, my darkness, to be placed on him, so that he could remove the darkness that separated us from the Father. Amen. Colossians chapter 1, verse 20, it says, "Having made peace." See, the Bible says right here in Isaiah 9, 6 that he is the Prince of Peace. "Having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him, I say, whether they be things in earth are things in heaven." Reconciliation means that there's parties that are separated from one another, and now they've been brought back together. The reality of it is that the fall of Adam has thrown the entirety of the world into the midst of disarray. Listen to me. I mean, I don't mean to start talking a bunch of stuff that maybe you've heard already, but mankind's answer, he's trying to answer things without God in the picture. I'll never forget. Whenever, I don't really know how else to describe it to you, because, and I think that is something that needs to be described. Sometimes people get mad whenever I talk about psychology or certain type of counseling that takes place that's outside of the Word of God. The reason that I do that is because of the fact that I have a history with that. First of all, I studied in nursing school, but what I need to tell you, and this kind of just came up the other day, well, I'm just going to tell you, like, in my past, I had gotten in so much trouble that whenever I graduated nursing school, maybe this will relate to some of you, I don't know, probably not, but when I graduated nursing school, I had been in so much trouble, and whenever I went to go fill out this form, it said, "Have you ever been accused of, convicted of a felony, accused of any crime greater than a traffic violation?" So here I am, a Christian. I just graduated nursing school. And so I had to answer yes. And so whenever I answered yes, it threw me into a whole new algorithm. Now the State Board of Nursing is contacting me, and then they want to know the whole story. So then I tell them the whole story. Oh boy, that was a mess. And the next thing you know, they're like, well, you got to go see an addictionologist. An addictionologist. A psychologist who specializes in addictions. And so he begins to ask me questions. And he wants to know, okay, well, I mean, I'm kind of embarrassed to tell you, but it is what it is. The Lord saved me, amen? Well, have you ever stolen anything? And see me, I'm just going to be honest with you. Sometimes it's not so good to be as transparent as what some people are. I'm like, did I steal stuff? Well, yeah, dude, I used to rob houses. And I used to tell him all this stuff. And he's like, no, you're a drug addict. You're a drug addict and you'll always be a drug addict. You can't be, you got it. And so his recommendation was that you go through this particular program. But I tried to tell him, but you don't understand, sir. Jesus, yeah, that's good. See? Amen. That's good. You got Jesus. But guess what? You're a drug addict, and you're always going to be a drug addict. What I'm trying to tell you is this, is that the world system, they don't understand nothing about your Jesus. Amen. And if you don't get me wrong now, if you find yourself in a situation where you have to go through counseling because the civil authorities of the society say that you have to do that because you broke some laws, guess what? You just need to learn how to shut your mouth and go through the process and get through it. But the reality of it is that they don't believe in your God, they don't believe in your Jesus, and even if they try to take, oh, well, I'm a Christian counselor, they will mix their psychology with the Word of God, and they will turn it into something that it never was. And the reality of it is that it cannot produce what it is supposed to produce. No, what the Prince of Peace came to do was he came to reconcile that which was separated from the light of God through the cross and our faith in that. He creates a completely different creation. He allows the light of God to come alive on the inside of you, and he produces a new creation in Christ. That which was previously separated from God has now been made whole with God. Amen. It says right here in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 19. Wherefore, remember that you, being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands. Circumcision meant the Jewish people, and the uncircumcision meant those that were not Jewish people. That at that time you were without Christ, meaning when you were of the uncircumcision or when you were a Gentile, you weren't a Jew. In the Old Testament, you didn't know nothing about the promises of Jesus. Even though they didn't know his name was Jesus, the Old Testament promised that he was coming. Does that make sense? And so the Jewish people knew it. You were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. In other words, you were separated. You didn't know nothing about their God. You were like the wise men that was born in the east, born in the midst of darkness. You were like the psychologist. Maybe that's why God wanted to bring it up. You were like the psychologist and everybody that believes like them, because they don't have God in the midst of their life. They don't have God in their story. They don't have God in their mind. And so therefore, they have to try to fix everything through some other avenue. And while they might be putting a band-aid in the midst of, on top of a bad situation, they'll never get down to the root of the problem, which is a heart issue that only God can reach into and do a work. He says, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who sometimes were far off are made near by the blood of Christ. We're talking about reconciliation. We're talking about exposing the evidence. We're talking about the light of the Word bringing you to the truth of Jesus. And when you receive it, reconciliation takes place. We're talking about the Prince of Peace, the one who provides peace, the one who makes peace between you and the Father, between you and the presence of God. For he is our peace, who's made both one, who's both, the Jewish people and the Gentile people. He made us all one. There's only one people now of God. They can continue to call themselves the people of God over there in Israel, but if they haven't received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, if they reject him as Messiah, they are not reconciled into a relationship with God. They're still separated from God. They're no different than what you were before you received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. He made both one, and he's broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that means the war, even the law of commandments, that was the law, contained an ordinance for the making himself of two, one new man, so making peace. I just need you to know he's the Prince of Peace. He's come to provide peace. That was what the light led them to. It led them to the evidence. The evidence that they saw was that he was God. The evidence that he saw was that he was the Prince of Peace. I can tell you right now that when they proscunioed or prostrated themselves before that king, and Aaron brought it out, and I know that Robert, it stuck in Robert's head, they left a different way. It literally means that I preached that a long time ago. It literally means that they went another direction. They didn't go in the direction Aaron told them to, but figuratively, they left another way. They were never going to be the same. You can't lay down your life and worship the king. You can't lay down and prostrate yourself before him and get up and be the same way that you ever were. Amen. You're going to be different when you lay your life down and give your heart to Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
Now, I want to go, I'm going to close with this verse right here. Numbers 24, verse 17. The title of my message, once again, was The Star of Bethlehem. The star separated light from darkness. The star provided guidance. The star brought them to the evidence. What this passage of Scripture says in Numbers 24, 17. Now, you got to understand that this is one of the first five books of the Bible. This talks about, you know, this is in the time frame whenever the children of Israel really haven't even rested in the promised land yet. They haven't even gotten to the time frame of King David or any of the kings yet. This is before all of that. It says, I shall see him. It's talking about Jesus right there. We know that looking backwards, but not now. I shall behold him, but not near. He's far off. He's coming. I'm going to see him, but it's not right now. And look at this. There shall come a star out of Jacob. Out of the lineage of Jacob. And the scepter shall rise out of Israel. That's talking about the king's staff. A star is going to be born. A king's going to be born. A child's going to be born. A son is going to be given. And he shall smite the corners of Moab and destroy the children of Sheph. What does that mean? He's going to destroy the enemies of God's people. The point that I guess I'm really trying to say with this last verse is this. Is that Jesus was the real star of Bethlehem that night. Amen. He was the real star of Bethlehem. He is the light that separates darkness. He is the light that guides us to the truth. And whenever that truth brings you to the destination, it's going to provide the evidence that you need in order to serve him. God has given us Jesus, and for Jesus' light to be on the inside of us. I know that I say this a lot. But I don't think I should apologize for this. The light that God gave in Jesus is now on the inside of you. If you've been born again.
Amen.
If you've been born again. See, the light is for everybody.
Amen.
The light is for everybody. It's to bring you to the place where you see the evidence. And then when you see the evidence, you got a choice to make. You're either going to believe it and lay your life down before it, worship him, give your life to him, or you're going to reject it. And the reality of it is this, is that that's the evidence, amen, that Jesus is the true star, and God wants him to rise up in our heart and to separate darkness from light on the inside of us.